I think the next speaker requires very little introduction. He is well known in successfully marrying the field of photovoltaic and artificial photosynthesis. And he has been mentoring a lot of faculty as well as students here in NTU. So it is my pleasure to introduce Professor Michael Graetzel. I think he needs some time to hook up his presentation. Okay. Very well. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Michael Graetzel.
Thank you, Lydia. It's a pleasure to be here. And actually, thanks to Bertel that we are here today. He has been the mastermind behind this meeting, and I'm so glad to have Jim with us. And I'd like to congratulate Jim on his 77th birthday, which happened last week. And and also, of course, he will receive the honorary degree tomorrow, which we all be assisting in this celebration. So my title slide shows actually, the work that Jim just mentioned, this splitting of water. Lydia was involved in this work, and it uses a mesoscopic iron oxide. The mesoscopic scale is very important because the carriers you produce in rust, iron oxide is rust, have a very short diffusion length. So they would only make it across few nanometers before they disappear. And so if you would use a film of iron oxide of, say, 400 nanometer thickness to absorb the light, you wouldn't be able to capture the carriers. But with this mesostructuring, you can do both absorb light and capture the carriers because of the feature size of those rods that is only a few nanometers. And so I will be... I'll be aiming in my talk to describe to you how we got there, the water splitting reaction. And so starting off with molecular photovoltaics, because after all, we're using molecules to generate charges, and these charges are either collected as electric current or they produce chemicals, oxygen from water, as we just heard. And the virtues of the mesoscopic architecture. That's been our prime activity in this field. We have also engendered the perovskite solar cells, which are now more efficient than polycrystalline silicon. So Eike has will defend this case, so I'm not worried about that. But photosynthesis shows the way. I mean, we have heard Jim just mention the 100 terawatts that is stored in fuels. I mean, there's more. There's wind generate all this hydroelectricity. But what is stored in fuels is 100 terawatts. That's about five times today's total energy consumption. And so we can learn from the plant. And one thing the plant does, it doesn't use a diode. It doesn't have a PN junction. And so the Dyson stress cell was the first to mimic, so one, the initial light reaction and charge generation from a molecular absorber. And so when we excite the dye, it injects an electron in the mesoscopic TiO2 film, we collect the charge, and then we need a shuttle to bring the electron back to the dye. And actually, the shuttle was over 20 years was always the iodide triiodide couple. He couldn't come up with a better shuttle. That was very embarrassing because we lost about half of the photon energy in that regeneration step. And so that pinned the efficiency of those cells at around 12%. That loss was just too big to take. But recently, you will see there has been a breakthrough, and I should mention the work of my colleague Anders Schockfeld, who came up with some new shuttles, and or he used them in a clever way. He wasn't actually the first to have thought about them, but use them in a clever way so that today we are at a minimal loss, 100 millivolts in the regeneration, and efficiency is going up very steeply again. And so this is the mesostructure, the dye on these nanoparticles. We need those nanoparticles to absorb light. If you had a flat monolayer of dye, the light would go right through. So it's like the chloroplast stacking in the green leaf. We have those stacked nanoparticles. And so we drive the electron transfer, and you mentioned the iodide, triiodide. This is the nanostructured film. It's about, it gives you a surface enhancement of about 1,200 times. So that's what helps you to capture the electrons. But not only, the electrons are screened by the ions on the surface, so that the charge separation is very efficient. And the contact itself is electron selective, as the photovoltaic experts say. It only accepts one type of charge from the sensitizer and not the other. So here's our paper in Nature, and it made that first for produce those thin film cells. But today, in my talk, I really want to give you the flavor of our present research. This is not a review talk. So today we have these new chromophores or sensitizers that use a donor acceptor function. So, like in Nature, we separate the charges by the cleverly construing the dye. When light is absorbed, the electrons move from top to bottom. And so the positive charge stays up and negative charge is in the nanoparticle. And that sets up a spatial separation between negative and positive, so that the charge separation lasts for milliseconds or seconds even before the charge recombines. That gives us a chance to collect those charges before they recombine. And so here's one dye that was conceived to be a good sensitizer. It has this donor function, the acceptor function. The carboxylate hooks the dye to the oxide. And here's the chromophore, which is very similar to chlorophyll, actually a green sensitizer. We got over 12% efficiency with this. And actually, this become now a commercial success. It's now made to the kilogram quantities. And you have applications like a car, electric car charging stations, and sound walls. And this is the Swiss highway from Bern to Zurich. And so it's integrating very nicely in the natural environment because of the green color. And also it works well in a vertical positioning. Why? Well, it captures light from both angles, and the efficiency is not strongly dependent on incidence of light for these kind of systems, of the angle of incidence. And so there was also the emergence of the copper 2-1. It also is borrowed from Nature. The blue copper protein, I think, has a copper complex that serves as an electron shuttle. And here we are going through now some very exciting times where you can see by using those copper complexes, we can get very close with the regeneration with the redox couple of the shuttle to the dye redox potential. And so the reason why this works well is the reorganization energy of this. If Rudy was, he would be delighted to hear that, is very small. And so we can drive the regeneration. Remember, this is what I showed you first, the iodide, triiodide. So here we are now with the copper complex. So the voltage of this cell has almost doubled by using the right shuttle. And the reorganization energy is very low. I have to show you that. If you take the copper 1, it's a tetrahedral geometry. Okay, you have the two bipyridyls. The bipyridyls, they are vertically arranged. The copper 2 would like to be planar, but we have those methyl groups which avoid the torsion, and so you just get a little bit torsion angle. And that creates a situation where you have low reorganization energy and fast electron exchange. That's what makes those copper complexes so so exciting. And so we have now the cells, for example, here's a cell that shows the EQE, that's the external quantum efficiency. You see, across the whole visible, over 90% of incoming photons are converted to electrons. And the wall at very high voltage and good fill factor. So that in diffuse light or ambient light, we are better than our strongest competitor, gallium arsenide. Okay. And that has actually given a rise also to solid state. In the solid state copper complex, you have the same hopping mechanism. It acts as a whole conductor. And you see, these are now Swedish products. It's a company in Stockholm, Exeger, that uses the DSCs for IoT application. And this is a e-reader, one of those Kindle e-readers, that has eternal life because it's the ambient light always gives enough reserve for the cell. The cell is actually this form. That's all a dye-sensitized solar cell. And so, as I said, the dye-sensitized cells produce, engender the perovskites, which have this very interesting optoelectronic properties. The structure is the ABX3. That's a very, very simple structure, but there are many variations. You can change the A cation and the B cation, the C cation, and so. So there's a lot of work going on. At present, we have about 1,000 papers published per year on those materials. So it's hard to follow that literature. But initially, I mean, what attracted people was the unusual band structure. You have the antibonding orbitals in the valence band. And so what that means is if you have a bond breakage, it doesn't produce a defect in the band gap. It's actually more stable if you break the bond than if you form the bond. That's the situation. And so these materials come at very low defect concentrations. But they emerged as sensitized, dye-sensitized cells, these being the quantum dots, made out of the perovskite quantum dots. And then it turned out that these electrolyte cells were very unstable, so a solid hole conductor was introduced. And so these two papers kind of triggered the rise of the perovskite solar cells, which is stunning. So compositional changes, multi-cation, I pass over that. And finally, we have today systems that are 22% efficient. That's on a laboratory scale, and but you can see they're slightly above the polycrystalline silicon. So, and the thing is still evolving. The field is evolving. But how about stability and cost? And so I will pass over the cost thing. But stable stability certainly has been improved. We have, especially these carbon cells. They turn out to be very stable. Carbon means that carbon is a collector, one of the charge collectors. We just published a paper on an experiment that lasts for 1 year, 1 year full power on the cell at 60 degrees and stable. So 12,000 hours stable. So if we put on the stress factor, the 11, then you have to multiply time times 11, then you get about 15 years, real lifetime. If that extrapolation is valid, it's been validated for dye-sensitized solar cell. We also came up with the inorganic hole conduct. So what turns out is that the contact materials are very often to blame for instability. And here's a new contact material. The cost is in US dollars, $0.5 per gram, and so far people had used those organics, about 1,000 times more expensive. You can see here also over 20% efficiency, and this is a stability test we performed recently. Very, very stable cells can be made. So we have been using these Prof Graetzel, as Jim mentioned, in a tandem configuration. And so I don't want to talk to you now about our solar fuel effort. So, we have been working both on combination of photovoltaics with the catalytic electrodes, and but we also are very strong defenders of photoelectrochemistry, where we excite the material itself and generate fuels. For example, here you would have a p-type electrode, and you excite it. The electrons would make hydrogen from water. That's Kubrick oxide does that, for example. And then you could use the positive charge to oxidize water to oxygen. But in all these cases, it turns out that you need a tandem like in nature. Nature has the two photosystems. A single photosystem is not enough to get the water cleavage or CO2 reduction going. The system we are discussing now is iron oxide. We actually started with TiO2. That's the work by Fukushima and Honda. But TiO2 has a very large band gap, and so you can't get any significant efficiency from sunlight. Iron oxide is a much stronger case. It's just it's a terrible material. It has lots of defects. As I mentioned to you, the diffusion lengths are very short. But I'm showing Jim's slide again in a tandem configuration. Where you use those nanorods, you can capture the holes before they recombine and make them oxidize water to oxygen. And so, the light that is not absorbed by iron oxide is used to drive this extra potential, to generate the extra potential required to get the hydrogen at the counter electrode. And so, this was the joint work with the group here at Singapore NTU, which showed for the first time that you can use visible light to split water into oxygen, hydrogen, using those mesoscopic photosystems in CS connected. But meanwhile, we also work on the combination of the perovskite, simply two perovskite cells put in CS here, and that's a water splitting experiment. So efficiencies went up 12.3%. And finally, how to get to solar fuel. So we are presently getting funded by Siemens, a company that sees a commercial case for turning CO2 into CO with sunlight, because they have too much electric power sometimes in Germany from the PV. There are peaks where that's too much, and so they also have these power plants where they produce CO2. CO2 has a negative value, so they're interested in a scheme where a sunlight would be used to reduce CO2 to fuel. Well, it's in water. If you have an aqueous system, it's better not to make a water soluble product, because then you have to separate it. But gas is CO, which is fine. CO is fine as a product. It can be mixed with hydrogen, and then you have a syngas and can make fuels in this way. So we started off with a triple perovskite to get the potential for reducing, for driving this reaction. This is CO, splitting of CO2 to CO and oxygen. So you're oxidizing water to oxygen, reducing CO2 to CO. That's a complete cycle. Water is used as electron source. Recently, we have actually been able to increase the efficiency to 13.4%. That's CO2 to CO under one sun. And the trick was to use the cathode and anode material, cuprous oxide that was treated with tin oxide to make it specific for reduction of CO2 to CO. If you don't do that, don't do the tin oxide layer, then you will get hydrogen formed on the cuprous oxide. And it's amazingly the same material, the the copper oxide can also be used as anode. You have same material on both electrodes. So it's also a catalyst for oxidizing water to oxygen. And so I just wanted to show you that Bill Gates became interested recently in solar fuels. I had met with Nate Lewis, and I, we saw him in 2012, and he's always keen to help mankind, okay? And so he became kind of infatuated with the solar fuel idea. And this spring he visited Nate's lab. Here's Nate Lewis. And he apparently he has raised $1 billion. So if you're short of money for your fuel research, there's an opportunity to get some funding. And so I'll finish. I think my time is almost up by just showing you some applications. These are all dye-sensitized solar cells. The pulse guides are not yet commercial, and nor are the fuels. They're still in research. But the dye-sensitized are now being sold on the market. And so, for example, we have these IoT applications. This is the magic DSC beacon. So I'm using the phrasing that the companies put out on the internet, okay? And so that's one. I showed you the indoor, the very efficient indoor performance and diffuse light, daylight, cloudy skies. So this is the strength of this technology. And also the backpack is one. I was fortunate to get a prize in Russia, and the Russians got very infatuated with the backpack. They asked me to bring one, and meanwhile, the company has lots of orders for this backpack from Russia, because they have many places where there's no electric power supply, and so that's a very good solution. And you know, we have the glass panels that are used in building integration, like our convention center. That's the indoor from indoor. That's a new project that is just now being terminated. We have an inauguration on September 21st. So 1,000 square meter of dye sensitized on one tower that is called the Scott Science Tower. With that, since our president is from Sweden, I thought I would show you a person he might know, the person in the middle, the Swedish king. He tape cutting procedure. That was 2 years ago, 3 years ago. But the company has done very well. They kept their whole development under the radar screen. They were afraid of some competition from Asia. Okay, but they very successfully built up this big plant, which is now at 20 megawatt manufacturing. And I showed you the products. So I showed you one of the products, this e-reader, but there are many others. And the job creation in Sweden. By the and if you're looking for a job, well, there are openings. Move to Sweden. with that, I'm at the end. Thank you for your attention. We still have snow in Switzerland. So thank you.